1, 2, 3, 1, 2.
God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please sing together, Amazed.
I never
Trust in you with all our hearts. For as you always resist the proud who confide in their own strength, so you never forsake those who make their boast of your mercy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
The first lesson is from Jeremiah. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Come, go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my words. So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. The vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand, and he reworked it into another vessel, as seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me. Can I not do with you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done? Says the Lord. Just like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. At one moment I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will pluck up and break down and destroy it. But if that nation, concerning which I have spoken, turns from its evil, I will change my mind about the disaster that I intended to bring on it. And at another moment, I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will build and plant it. But if it does evil in my sight, not listening to my voice, then I will change my mind about the good that I have intended to do to it. Now, therefore, say to the people of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, look, I am a potter shaping evil against you and devising a plan against you. Turn now, all of you from your evil way, and amend your ways and your doings. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
The reading of Psalm 139. Please respond by half verse. Lord, you have searched me out and known me. You trace my journeys and my resting places.
And you are acquainted with all my ways.
Indeed, there is not a word on my lips.
But you, O Lord, know it all together.
You press upon me behind and before.
Lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. I will thank you because I am marvelously made.
Your works are wonderful, and I know well.
My body was not hidden from you.
God has been made in secret, and more than the depths of the earth.
Your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb. All of them were written in your book. How deep I find your thoughts, O God.
How great is the sum.
If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand. The word of the Lord.
The second lesson is from Paul's letter to the Philemons. Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Aphia, our sister, and to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank my God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith toward the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though, I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty. Yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Jesus Christ. I am appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful, both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is, my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I preferred to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this letter with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me, even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. The word of the Lord.
And to sing together, change my heart, O God. Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, "This fellow began to build and was not able to finish." Or what king going out to wage war against another king will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then, while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give me all your possessions. Do you not give up all your possessions? The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. When I talked to the children earlier in the day, I asked them to tell me about God, because this is a dialogue sermon, if you remember, and I was going to get a dialogue with the children. And none of them could come up with much of anything. And so I told them about when I was a kid, I used to think about God all the time, and that God was some other that existed way beyond my imagination. And I would think about God, and I would get lost in my thoughts and start to feel afraid. And it wasn't an accident that I'd feel afraid, because of pressing thought that God was going to get me if I messed up was always there in all of my church experience. And I had this image that God was somewhat like the Jonathan Edwards sinners in a hand of an angry God, where if I messed up, God was just going to turn his hand over and I was going to fall down into the abyss and burn in the pits of hell. Later on, I began to recognize that God had a much softer image in that is seen through Jesus Christ. And I began to realize that this was who God really was. God was the creative impulse who gave us life and wanted us to have life in eternity. I tell you that, as I told the children, to remind you that God loves you, and he loves you all the time. This is a dialogue sermon, and at least one of you has a question. What is your question?
What are I supposed to be about a certain thing?
See, I told you had to write it down because I can't hear you. So now you had to go to the, you had to come up here and say the question so everyone can hear you.
Is it supposed to just be anything I want to ask?
Something that pertains to the gospel, hopefully. But let's see if, let's see if I can get over here.
Come back to me.
Chicken. Anybody else? Any questions? Now see, I always feel like a good sermon is a sermon preached from a heuristic way in which when you leave here, you're going to have more questions than you came with. And obviously that's going to be easy because you didn't bring any questions. However, someone gave me questions this morning. And the first question was, as we as Episcopalians are part of the Christian faith, our beliefs expressed in the Nicene Creed form the basis of our faith. Since other faiths may or do not share our beliefs, how can they attain the spiritual goals we seek? I thought that was a good enough question, so I pursued it. When he's talking about other faiths, he's talking about Buddhists, Hindus, Muslims, all those other faiths that are out there. All with some approach to somewhere, right? The goal, that's the goal. And as I read it, I thought, well, this has something to do with goals. And all the conflict between religious bodies, the different faiths, have to do with misplaced goals, right? The goals are to God, right? They're sent to God. And whatever way we can picture God. As a child, it was hard for me to even reach to that goal because the God that I imaged, that was a presenting itself to me was a God of wrath that would mete out justice for me anytime. So I believe this question is sort of misunderstood in that our faith, right, is grounded in something. And we all have faith in different things. You have faith in the sun coming up in the morning, right? And yet we know that that's not really what happens. Anybody that's studied science knows that the earth is turning, and when the sun rises in the east, we're just turning toward it, right? And we can see it because it's in our horizon. So our faith can be misplaced easily as well. So I started thinking as I got this question and read it a little bit that the goal that everyone seeks, I believe, is peace. If you've ever received any email or message from me, my articles, I always end it with peace. And I do that because I want peace. I had a lot of times in my youth when I didn't experience peace. So I believe the goal is peace. Now, I wouldn't be a preacher worth my salt if I didn't reference the gospel, which is why I got you to read the gospel in advance before coming up with the question. And this gospel is hard, isn't it? I didn't pick this gospel out. This was given to us by the lectionary people for my last sermon with you. And there were large crowds, imagine that, large crowds. If you read my newsletter article, which I hope you did, and if you didn't, you still have time before you meet your maker. And in it I asked you to read Joshua 24, which is the end of Joshua's journey. He's about to die. He's about to give his last sermon. And he says to the people, he says, all these things have happened to you. And then he says, we're going to enter into this land. And this is, any biblical scholar knows that in the promises that God gives to us in the covenant relationship, the promise is always about people and land. And if you think about it, the land is already there. They didn't create it. They don't have to do anything to earn it. It's a gift. So the people are the real important thing here. Just as when God created everything, he said, when he created people, this is very, very good. And Joshua's standing there among a large crowd of people, just like Jesus is in this story today, and he says, choose this day whom you will serve. As for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. Y'all know that scripture? Some of you have it on your house, you know, when people walk in the door. Choose this day whom you will serve. As for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. And then they say, the whole crowd rises up and says, we'll serve the Lord too. We're going to serve the Lord. And this is the point. I wanted you to enter into this story in a visceral way so that you could feel it. Feel the tension in the room. Feel the hair on the people's arms rising up. Because Joshua turns to them, this great leader, this leader who's been through all sorts of stuff. Because if you remember the story, he saw some people prophesying outside the tent. Remember, Eldad and Medad prophesying outside the tent. He goes to Moses. He says, you got to stop these people. And Moses says, look, Joshua, you're not quite there yet. Your focus is not right. We want all of our people, all of God's people to prophesy. And they knew that. All these people saw the things that Joshua went through. And here he says to them, after they say, we're so deluded, you can't do it. You're not going to be able to do it. And they're going, what? Of course we can. And what he's telling here is something important, and I think it matches up with this story that we read today. Because Jesus says, if you don't give up, the large crowds are with him. And he says, whoever comes to me doesn't hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even life itself cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. That's hard stuff, isn't it? Now, what's he saying there? He's telling us something about possessions because he finishes it by saying you have to give up all your possessions. And he said this over and over again. So this morning when I read this and thought about how I might fit all this in, I recognized that the questioner had missed a few things because in the image that I read this question under, I think of whoever is writing this is thinking that somehow we have this higher ground that we're looking at our faith from. And then I remembered the article that was in the newspaper this week about our big shindig on the 10th, a Saturday that's only a few days away. So 6 days as I count. And it says in the end, all these flowery things it says about me, so I really thought it was a great article. And then at the end, it says, and we're going to have beer and wine at our thing. And I'm going, huh? Well, when the beer and the wine is what got me, and I thought, Madison, Alabama, you know, these people looking in, the Baptists, what are they going to think? And I thought, well, we're Episcopalians. That's okay. That's why I'm an Episcopalian. And then I looked at the bulletin this morning before I got this fine question, and I saw that we're having Bunko on the 16th. And there's a thing of dice right there in the picture. And I'm thinking, okay, well, maybe we need to relook at our faith and think what our faith is in. And Jesus says, none of you can become my disciple if you not give up all your possessions. Jesus is saying something here that he says over and over again. If you remember at the tomb, he's risen from the dead. And Mary comes to him. And Mary clings to him, right? She immediately glums on to him when she realizes it's the Lord. And he says, don't hold on to me. I'm going before you to Galilee. If you want to be with me, you're going to have to be on the move otherwise. Don't stop here. Don't rest on your laurels. Don't read your newspaper clippings about how great you are and then think that's enough. Jesus is saying to him, not that you have to abandon your family, but you have to realize that if your goal is peace, sometimes anyone can get in the way. Anyone. Anyone telling you something that says, well, maybe you ought not to do that, even though you know it's a godly goal, right? And there are some things we're told not to do, Charles, that we shouldn't do. Right? But if you've got your eyes on God and your goal is that peace that passes understanding, then anyone can get in your way and often does. So Jesus is saying what he said over and over again, consistently, keep your focus on God through me and you will see the Father. This isn't my last sermon, and I wanted it to be a dialogue because I think that it's important for us to bring out what's inside, to go down deep and pull out whatever it is down deep inside so that we can look at it in the light of day and decide whether or not it's real or not and worthy of our pursuits. Someone else wrote a question. I said it could be words, it just wrote family and church, right? Because this is about family, giving up your father, your mother, all those things. And there's other scriptures here as well. There's a story from Philemon, where Paul is writing Philemon from prison, and he's obviously got a relationship with Philemon that's strong, and he says, I want you to think about Onesimus. And the way he talks about Onesimus is like, this is my family. This is my son. He's caring for me in prison. I want you to think about him this way. This man was a slave. And I like it. I liken that story to when I was first brought back into the church. I was 25 years old. We're going to celebrate 25 years. And I thought about this church as 25 years old. And how what happens to you at 25 when things change in your life. And for me, a big change occurred when Jesus came into my life. And I went from living here in the one world and moving over here into another. And my friends couldn't deal with it. Many of them left. Many of them couldn't accept that this was a real thing. This too shall pass, they thought. Two of them are going to be here on the 10th. And I'm so grateful that I've been able to maintain those relationships. Before I came from this side over to here, I had given up on the idea of being with God because of my image of God. But when I came over here, I realized that my image of God was flawed, that Jesus was wanting me to be with him and wanting a relationship with me, and things began to change. Not overnight did everything get rosy. But every time I went through anything, any change, any difficulty, I experienced this peace in the knowledge that God was with me and that I didn't have to worry about anything as long as I kept my focus on everything, the God of the universe. Family and church. What's Jesus saying about family and church here? We can look at this through the eyes of Paul's letter to Philemon. He's saying that once, just like I was, Onesimus was a slave. And I was a slave. I was a slave to those old ideas. I was a slave to this idea that God had his eye on me, just waiting for me to mess up. And then I was free. And in my freedom, Paul is saying, embrace this person as your brother and see what you'll get. I am leaving, and there's going to be some challenges ahead. In my first church, early on, I'd been there a couple of years. I discovered this woman, and she had great gifts, and she was very willing to help, Elizabeth. And Elizabeth told me she would be willing to take over the production of our newsletter. And I thought, great. And I got her some training. I found a workshop, a newsletter workshop that would teach her all about the nuances of making a superior product. And she got really good at it. She had a husband named Bill, and Bill, he was also very gifted. Bill's greatest gift was irritating me. Almost every Monday, he would show up in my office, and he would have something to complain about. The acolytes in the bulletin were wrong. Someone shouldn't have been saying something. Now, Bill was very smart. He had a business where he supervised dozens of engineers, and he got there even though he only had a high school education. Bill had worked on Elizabeth to the point that one day, the Tuesday before Thanksgiving, and you know Thanksgiving is always the end of the month, last Thursday of the month. When I came here, the newsletter often was full of typos and would often have stories that were from a month before or even 2 months before. And it would often get published around the 12th or the 13th when events that were in the newsletter were happening on the 2nd or the 3rd. And I told Kathy when I walked in the office and saw that, I said, I want you to think Mussolini. The trains will arrive on time. I may be called a lot of things, but I'm always prompt. I want to be on time. And I think it's important that we get information when it's necessary to get it. And so when this woman came in, Elizabeth, and put this box of papers up to here on my desk of newsletter stuff, and she was angry, and she said, I quit. I've had enough. And she was irritated about some little bitty nitpicking thing. I was devastated. I wasn't at peace. I thought, what will I do? How am I going to approach this? I got to get that newsletter out, and if I'm true to my ideals, I'm going to get it out on time. And I began to look at this vast array of stuff and the little bit of stuff that I knew needed to be in the newsletter, and I was at a loss. And in walked this young woman, brand new to the church, been there a few months, and beautiful young woman, beautiful family, two beautiful kids, a husband that was really handsome and gifted. And she said, what's the matter? You're always so upbeat. You're always telling us to be happy, seize the day, all those things. And I said, Elizabeth just came in and put this box on my desk. And she's quit the newsletter, and it's the 4th of the month. And I have to get this newsletter out, and I don't know where to start. And she said, that's easy. I can help. Me and Doug will help. We'll make it happen. How about Friday after Thanksgiving? I thought about it for a minute. I said, okay. So we met Friday after Thanksgiving. And being the hospitable person I was, I provided some liquid refreshment. And I put some music on. And they were working like the devil. And I would give little instruction, and they were working, and they were running the copy machine and printing these things. And KK got tired, and she came and sat down in my office. I said, KK, relax, prop your feet up. I'm going to read you a paper I wrote in seminary. And I looked through my files and pulled out a paper on the Trinity and started reading it to her. 5 minutes later, she was conked out. Very peaceful. And then they became my family. That's what Jesus is saying here. Just like he did a few chapters back. Who is my family? This is my family. Now the curious thing, he's telling this story, and then he goes on to tell about building a tower. And I read that and I thought, how many people have built a tower in this church lately? And it took me a while to put my mind around that one. And then I realized one of the reasons why I'm here is because of that bell tower out there. When I walked in for my interview, I was very uncertain whether I wanted to be here, but I saw that bell tower and I knew the church had $350,000 in debt. And I thought any church that has built a bell tower without a bell and taken on $350,000 in debt, they have visions. And that's what we need. In the days ahead, we need vision. We need to not hold on to the past, but look for that light that God is leading us with. The light will always guide us to the next step. Now, just as Paul's writing to Philemon, he says, I know y'all are going to do, you're going to do exactly what I say and more, right? We got stewardship coming up, and stewardship chairperson, and they're kind of nervous because what are we going to do without our cheerleader here, they said. And I said, keep your eyes on the goal. Keep your eyes on that peace that passes understanding. Make that number one and you will get there. You don't need to worry about it. Because the most important thing here is the people that God sends us. If we pay attention to that and treat everybody like Onesimus, a freed slave, and love on those people, great things will happen. But just as Joshua said, you're going to mess up. When I came up here, I remembered that KK and Doug had moved up here and rekindled my relationship with them, my family, my children. And they said, called me and told me one of their daughters was playing basketball at Bob Jones. And I got real excited. And I thought, oh, I can do this. I want to go see it. But I got tied up in things and the time was getting short and I was going to ride my bicycle there and I took off on my bicycle. And I'm riding down the parking lot at Bob Jones and you know it goes down like this from Hughes Road just like ours does. And I was furiously going down and I didn't see a bumper. And I hit a bumper and went over the handlebars. I had scratches, blood, and I got up only like I can do. And I dusted myself off and walked in and got that peace back. I tell you that because there's going to be some bumps in the road. That's what Joshua was telling them. That's what Jesus was telling us today. He's saying there's going to be some bumps in the road, but be at peace because I'm always going to be with you. That love that generated the universe is always going to be with us. Keep our eyes on the prize and we won't have to worry about anything else. Make your goals high. And let go of all those weights that burden you, the shoulds and the ought tos. Know that if you have a great idea, to pursue it. Don't be afraid. Ask those questions. And trust that God will lead you. Because no matter where you are in life, no matter how difficult your life has been, God can change that and make you into one of God's angels. And that's good news. Those with ears to hear, let them hear. Let's stand and say the creed of the church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty. Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. Accept and fulfill our petitions. We pray not as we ask in our ignorance, nor as we deserve in our sinfulness, but as you know and love us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace. Peace, Brenda. Peace, Sue. Peace, Colin. Peace, Louis. Peace, Brian. Please be seated. Please be seated. Please be seated. Is this too premature? Am I asking you to be seated too quickly? Hey, everybody, welcome. It's good to see you. Please be seated. Please be seated. Okay, here, I got good news. Good news. Here's good news. Good news. One of our young men called this week and said, we have a new Episcopalian. Pim, congratulations, Pim Mendez. And his father-in-law, Grandpa, good to see you here as well. And a new beautiful little baby. And then the Grumman family has a new grandchild, Grace Saxon Patterson. And he is a beautiful boy. And they both were born a day apart. Both of these children born a day apart at Huntsville Hospital. Okay, congratulations. Anyway, we got a lot of things to talk about. Bunko, of course, that's a week from Friday. That's a good thing. You'll want to be there. I won't be here. This is my last Sunday. I'm going to be here Saturday, though, and so will the band, and we're going to be here Friday night as well, so if you want to come, it'll be a lot more casual Friday night. We're going to have t-shirts. Jason has his t-shirt on. Charles has his t-shirt on. Charles, where's Charles? Oh, he's gone. Anyway, we got t-shirts for sale. They're $5. They're beautiful t-shirts. We want you to wear them Saturday, Friday, if you will, and if you wear them Friday, wash them and bring them back Saturday. But wear, dress casual, band. I know that's hard for you. And we're going to celebrate this 25 years of being an Episcopal presence in this community. My retirement is going to be glorious. We're going to have bouncy things and water slides for the kids. That'll start sometime around noon. Kids, come on over. Use your bathing, bring your bathing suits. Bring a change of clothes if you plan on staying. You can come, you can go. 2:30, we're going to have worship, confirmation. It's going to be glorious. And then we're going to come out here and we're going to celebrate our 25 years of being here by burying a time capsule. We're going to have some music by Black Market Haggis. And then we're going to have our feast of a pig roast, and it's going to be glorious. And then we're going to come in here and listen to my friend Beverly Owens sing and play. And Zach Grumman, my son, is going to play with Beverly. She's an angel. You'll benefit by hearing her. And then we're going to have what they're telling me is a roast, and I hope it'll be gentle and kind and loving, and the band will be here to at least support me with beautiful music. And I understand we're going to play I'll Fly Away, at least. What a great song to end on. We're not moving, not moving, at that, not moving. We'll be in the community, and hopefully maybe someday after the new priest is here, I can come back and participate in some way. However, I cleaned my office out, and I have some special artwork that I'm going to have to get rid of, okay? I'm giving it to the women of the church to sell at their auction. So if you want some of it, you're going to have to bid on it. So that's another thing that's happening. Now, when you come Saturday, Friday probably won't be as big a problem, but Saturday we need you to pay attention to parking. If you are a person that can walk more than a mile, you can park at Bob Jones High School, right? If you're a person that can walk more than 100 yards, you can park in the back fields back here and over there, way back there. Please do that. That'll be very important. The other thing is, Al Turner tells me that the slots to put coals underneath the pig at the early morning hours, 1, 2, 3, 4, those hours, need some support. So if you haven't signed up and you are an insomniac, this is for you. So sign up. It's out there. Okay. We also have, it looks like, some other things going on. Pay attention, because on the 11th, that's the day after the 10th, it always is, we're going to have the beginning of Sunday school. So even though you've come here, you've celebrated, you've gone out from here into the Grubman Hall to dance with the Cracker Jacks, at 9 o'clock we're going to shut her down, turn the lights off, because we want you to go to bed and come back here the next day, because we have Sunday school. And we got worship again. And Father Sam will be here for all three services. So don't think you're not going to have a 5 o'clock service. You will. It's going to be glorious. So let's do that. Let's make this weekend a spirit-filled weekend where we can all come together and seek that goal, the higher goal of God, a walk in Jesus. And ascribe to the Lord the honor due His name, bring offerings and come into His courts.
Thank you.
All things come of thee, O Lord,
and of thine own have we given.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption. O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him, in the unity and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray.
Our Father in heaven,
of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven, the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation.
You feel the pain of the
Father, you have graciously accepted us
as living members of your Son and our Savior Jesus Christ. You have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world of peace and grant strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Please sing together. Shine, Jesus, shine.
Oh,
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.